Hi, welcome once again to this series on NewsClick, the series that we're running on the Master Plan Delhi, that's MPD 2041. 2021 gets exhausted, and then 20 years down the line, how Delhi is to be shaped. Shape doesn't just mean land use plan, but also how mobility is to affect. What would be the environmental prospects of Delhi 20 years down the line? And of course, when we talk about Master Plan, it has to be quite inherently linked to the people. So how are people affected? Well, we've done a series, and since this is the third episode, we've already spoken about the trajectory and the journey right from 1961 to 2041. And today we have Jasmine Singh. Welcome, Jasmine, to this
series. Hi.
And so with Jasmine, we are going to speak about mobility, environment. I mean, what does the master plan speaks about these two aspects? And just to give you a reference, Jasmine is an architect planner working in Hyderabad, but also who comes from Delhi, who's been brought up in Delhi and has an experience of more than 15 years in this planning field. So someone who understands the nuances of urban planning, which most of the people do not, and why it is important for the people to get engaged in this and that. So this is what we're going to ask Jasmine. So Jasmine, I mean, what is your take on the MPD?
Yeah, hi. So as you've introduced me, I have a long association with Delhi. You know, it's been, barring the last 3 years, all my life has been mostly in Delhi. And even my families, when they came to India from at the time of the partition, so they all settled. And we've seen how Delhi has developed, you know, from the New Delhi to the refugee.
And in the previous episode, actually, we heard those stories from Dunu about, you know, the partition.
I don't want to go into stories. My grandparents also were allotted a plot in these refugee colonies, and how Delhi has developed from that. Delhi was nothing before that. And what we see today, it has about 1.4% of India's population, which is huge. You know, it is a big magnet, especially when you look at North India. It has been the biggest magnet to attract people. And when you look at the population growth, like the past two decades, it had slowed down. You know, it has come to around 20-21%, but earlier it was growing pretty fast. And the previous master plans, it talked about that the population growth, migration is contributing 50% equally as well as the natural growth. So migration has always been a very important, has played a very important part in Delhi. You know, everybody, कहाँ जाना है दिल्ली में जाके नौकरी कर रही है. दिल्ली हैज द वाज द प्लेस फॉर अ लैंड ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटीज. यू नो इट हैज बीन लाइक दैट. एंड व्हेन यू लुक एट द करंट मास्टर प्लान यू सी अ शिफ्ट. यू नो द मास्टर प्लान डॉक्यूमेंट इटसेल्फ, नाउ व्हेन यू स्टार्ट रीडिंग द डॉक्यूमेंट, इट सेज दैट दिस इज अ इट्स अ फ्रेमवर्क. यू नो सो दे हैव देमसेल्व्स दे आर शिफ्टिंग. यू नो व्हाट द प्लान
What does that mean? I mean, shift from what to what?
Because when people look at the 2001, 2021 plans, they talk a lot of the special needs, the requirements, what the population needs, what will be required in the next 20 years. But now in the 2041, we see that it says it's a spatial framework. It talks more on that. But then the framework lacks how the framework will be implemented and what will be the timelines.
Yeah. So Jasmine, I mean, when you say spatial framework, what does it mean, spatial framework, for our viewers who actually do not know the nuances of urban planning?
It talks that it is a framework. It's a guiding document because you have multiple agencies in Delhi. And now what you see, DDA at one point was also taking up development works. DDA is not doing that anymore. You have different agencies, you have three municipal bodies, you have a cantonment board, you have a NDMC. So it is more of a guiding document of what these agencies would be doing, basically. But what's the stark difference I see, that when the previous master plan, it talked the 2021, it talked about figures, what is the urbanizable area in Delhi, how much is under, all that has actually been removed from the master plan. So the previous master plan spoke that in 2000, about 47% of Delhi was already urbanized, and there was a scope, you know, another 18% to reach around 66%. But all of that is totally missing, you know. And even when you look at the population projections, what is being projected is about 22.9 crores for 2041. And even the previous master plan, 2001, they had proposed like 2.35 crore, but they actually fell short. So the population growth is actually coming down, you know. So we don't know whether we will actually reach 2.9 is a huge figure, you know. I think you will have maybe one or two cities in the world which would actually reach that scale in the coming few years. So that is how and why you need a master plan is to basically account for the growing needs. And what the document actually talks about is giving a quality of life to the people, safeguarding the environment, conserving the heritage. That has been consistent, that every master plan has talked about. So that is nothing very different. But the good, but what I see, they have spent a lot of time this year, NIUA, last 3-4 years, they've got experts, they've prepared these baseline studies. And the baseline studies, even though it was after a lot of insistence, they actually released to the public. And that is, I think, one of the reasons that they've extended the timeline, because every study itself is a 100-page document. So baseline studies captures a lot of things, but I don't see everything of the baseline captured in the master plan. Master plan is more generic.
I mean, that's really interesting what you're saying, that there is a baseline study, but the baseline study doesn't reflect in the master plan. So can you cite a few examples, I mean where such a thing has happened?
Like when we talk of, let's take the case of environment, you know, it talks of things like that there has been an increase in the green cover, but what is the final target? They say that we want to reach 30% and currently we're at 20, but what does the 20 mean? It is not very clear. If they are even including the avenue plantation, that is not green spaces, you know. So there is a conflict in that. Then the other thing is that in the baseline study, they say that most of the afforestation, which is happening in Delhi, has been happening in the ozone. Okay. So anywhere they're cutting trees and they're saying, okay, compensatory, you will go and plant in ozone. But then the people residing in other zones, they are deprived of the green spaces or the benefits of trees and the biodiversity, the ecology. So that is there in the baseline, but it is not reflected in the master plan. And the master plan says that, you know, when you have different zones in Delhi and there is a huge variation in the per capita green space, like New Delhi, it goes beyond 250 square meter a person. And in certain zones, it's hardly not even 3 square meter, which is well below the 10 square meter, what we call as a global standard. So there is a huge variation. But then what is proposed to bridge that gap? You know, areas which have such a low green cover, how will you increase the green cover there? The previous master plans did talk of space allocation, allocating land for, you know, parks or even infrastructure, but this plan doesn't talk about that. How in a particular zone those things will be augmented. Maybe they are leaving it to the zonal plan or the local plan, but that has been a problem with the previous master plans also.
My point is, I mean, that's very interesting that you pointed out. I mean, you know, we've also seen some of the redevelopment projects taking place. For example, the Ames, I mean, close to Ames, and then now TOD is coming up. So do you not think, I mean, this is, this will further reduce the green cover, I mean, where you require more green spaces in a...
The green cover, I think, is quite contentious, how they are calculating, because the 21 master plan had a different figure. Now they are giving a different figure here. What all they are in, it is not in sync. And we already know with the phase 4 metro coming up, lot of, even in the southern ridge, certain areas are going to go away. So all those things have not been taken cognizance, you know. what are the further infrastructure development and how it will affect the green cover. Nothing of that sort has been done. And another thing, like the master plan is shifting to a KPI-based evaluation. You know, they have made different parameters and these parameters will be analyzed.
Performance indicators you're talking about.
But then when you look at environment, the only parameter they talk is, okay, increase in green cover or assessing the number of good air days. But they're totally ignoring the biodiversity. The master plan, the baseline says that the Yamuna has hardly any biodiversity left. No aquatic life, the aquatic life is hardly there. So how those things are not at all, you know, taken into the master plan. It is good that they have taken cognizance of the green blue infrastructure and, you know, that they want to connect the green blue infrastructure, making it a more livable city. But those things they haven't, the biodiversity is one thing which has totally been ignored, because trees or green spaces are not just, they don't perform one function. It is a whole ecosystem which really needs to look at it. Then another thing coming to is the air pollution. You know, like Delhi, we know the most polluted capital.
One of the most polluted cities in the world,
The capitals, we've been getting that tag last 2-3 years. And it's like nothing to be happy about. But on climate change, pollution, it is very generic, you know. The master plan says that, okay, 25% is due to domestic pollution. 25%, it is a huge. So what it indicates that maybe cooking gas or fuels or unclean fuels, because domestic pollution would be from these sources. So how the master plan, and it points to the slums or the informal settlements where we know that these things would be used. So how these things would be taken up, we are not, it is totally silent on that. Pollution is just, okay, we will monitor the number of good air days. But it doesn't help in any ways, because we are reading a lot of...
smog towers. It also speaks about smog towers.
Smog towers, you know, and smog tower is a very, it's not a proven technology. China did it in some cities. Now in India, making it as a, you cannot replace the natural lungs with a smog tower. Or even using terms like Miyawaki plantation. Miyawaki, okay, we can do it in a resort, in a group housing. I cannot do it on acres and acres. It's an expensive technology. So I think some of the solutions which are being suggested would create further problems, which is...
Okay, so I think that's interesting framework to solutions that are being offered. Now, you know, there is also a strong connect between pollution and mobility. The way we are actually inducing our people to buy more cars by widening our flyovers, occupying the space of the pedestrians and whatnot. And then we've also seen the TOD coming up. The transit oriented development, which is like a catchword for the 2041 master plan. So now, how do you look at it? And is it also just the jargon that they talk about, or something real is going to happen?
The TOD is nothing new. You know, couple of years back, 2012, DDA came out with the TOD policy, and they said, okay, there will be 5-6 stations which will be taken up, but it hasn't taken up at the level what they had.
But Jasmine, do you not think, TOD still caters to a certain section of the middle classes? Delhi is not just the middle class or the upper middle class, you know. Delhi is...
Now, what you see globally, when you look at, you know, Canada or certain cities in America where they have gone for TOD, the focus of TOD has been to have affordable housing in the TOD radius so that the people staying there, they can easily walk to work, they can take the metro or whatever the transport is offered. But here they talk of, you know, 600 square feet, 60 square meter. So in most countries where TOD has worked, it has been making smaller unit size more affordable, having policies so that the people staying within that 5 to 10 minutes of that station or the node, they are able to access the facilities, you know. For a person who can afford a car, they can or cars, you know, multiple cars, they can as well stay in Mehroli or Chhatarpur or somewhere. They don't need to stay in that TOD zone. So TOD will work only if you have, only if it is focused more on the affordable segment. But that has been, even in Gurgaon, the TOD policy, they haven't focused on that. How to make housing affordable near these nodes. And naturally, a person who has the kind of money, they wouldn't like to stay in those, it will be hustling, bustling. It won't be a very dense zone. So that balance has to be achieved. So I think that, and TOD has been there last 10 years. They haven't achieved much of it. They've again put it in the master plan. And now they say that a developer or some private party can propose this TOD scheme. If you have an area, certain, I think one hectare or 2 hectare more, you can do a TOD scheme proposed to us and you will get extra FAR. And certain percentage of public space in the scheme, it has to be a public plaza given back to the city. Now, how that will work, who will maintain that, activities will be allowed in the public plaza. You know, Delhi is a city of hawkers, street vendors. So to make these public plazas vibrant, what will be allowed? You know, will the private party control even the activities happening there? They can allow access to people, it's okay, but we want the inclusive access. Delhi is a city where you have weekly markets, vendors. How do you take them on board? And today, most of the metro stations that you look in Delhi, you know, once you get down the metro, it is a chaotic zone. It's not planned. You know, you have autos, cycles, you have these e-rickshaws, buses. It is quite that entire zone. So I think more local area planning needs to be done at that level.
I think that's very interesting that you pointed out, because this is what Romy and I, we've been discussing since long, local area planning and passing on this the buck of planning to local bodies, panchayats at the Gram Panchayat level and also
other local bodies.
Level. Yeah, at the ward level, precisely at the ward level. So, but then the last question that I want to ask Jasmine is about how do you look at the mobility sector in this entire master plan?
When you look at the mobility, the baseline studies...
You know, because your buses have come down. I mean...
The baseline is very clear. The buses have come down. We are hardly left with 6,000 buses. And actually, it should be 11,000 to 12,000 buses, you know. The past few years, we've been hearing so many EVs will be added. And one latest study is saying that most of these 6,000 are even aging, you know. So, few years down the line, most of them will be redundant. And what had happened in Delhi was like 15 years back, they experimented with the BRT. So I wouldn't say that the BRT failed. It was the implementation and the public awareness on that Chirag Delhi stretch, what they tried to do, the BRT. But in the long run, what we see, bus-based will be the mode of transport, because when you, studies have been done, you know, when you compare a metro ride for people earning more than 25, 30,000 salary, when they travel by metro and they take another last mile, first mile, after a metro again to reach your workplace, you'll take another mode, okay? So that turns out pretty costly for them. And that is why people have been switching more to two-wheelers. And two-wheelers have increased a lot. So how to even reduce, and two-wheelers are causing a lot of pollution as per the IIT Delhi study. The only solution is to have more bus-based transport, which will be within 5 minutes of your house. Today, even to access the metro station, you need to take another e-rickshaw or some other.
But Jasmine, if you go by another baseline study that was done again by IIT, I think 48% of the commuters commute in a radius of less than, who are non-motorized, to say.
Yes.
Yeah. So they are either pedestrians or they are cyclists. I mean, how does the 241 plan address that? You know, that's a big chunk, almost 50% of
the
population who are not dependent on the government. So, you know, they require more open spaces for walking, maybe with tree cover so that in the summers they can walk. And of course, the cycle paths. I mean, so how do you look at it?
They specify that, you know, in these new schemes, be it TOD, be it land pooling, be it these green development zones, so cycling and pedestrian footpaths, the street design guidelines will be mandatory. But my question is, why only in these new developments? You know, why not do it everywhere in the city? and they talk of all roads above 12 meters should follow the street design guidelines. So these UTPEC street design guidelines have been there. They've been there last 10, 15 years, you know. But it, the agencies themselves responsible, because, you know, some roads are under PWD, some are under CPWD. There are multiple agencies. So I think capability of these agencies also is required to be upgraded. So they implement these street design guidelines. That is one good aspect that they have stressed on the street design guidelines. And the, one of the KPIs that they have mentioned is, you know, they will measure how many streets above 18 meter are designed as per these guidelines. So these guidelines can work provided they take the hawkers, the vendors, the people whose livelihood is dependent on the streets. You know, you need to integrate those people. And as we are looking at Delhi today, because most industries, polluting industries, have shifted out or they are not allowed. So Delhi is becoming, I think, more of a trading, shopping. It has changed. And even offices, if you look at the offices, either they have shifted within NCR. Only the corporate offices are there. So Delhi is more of a trading and a trading city, I would say, and less of a industrial city today.
I think, yeah, that's apparently true, because that's what Dunu was also pointing out, you know, how they had designed some 17 industrial zones, only 5 could materialize, 12 could not, even in the initial days. Forget about, I mean, when the industries were shifted. So your last word, I mean, because, you know, it still doesn't grip not the sense of the people, but, you know, people are not even aware, and probably the DDA doesn't even want the people to be aware. I mean, yeah. Unlike what we have witnessed in the earlier master plans, where there used to be a Munadi kind of thing. I mean, there were proclamation. That thing doesn't happen. I mean, it's all IT, and everyone is not IT, no?
Yeah, because, you know, the previous master plan and last master plan, you know, there was a lot of uproar regarding the mixed use and shopkeepers, and, you know, the traders were up against. They got some 7,000 objections, and they held various workshops, talking to people, calling people. Now, because of the pandemic, they are saying we can't do that. They've just done 4 webinars, and one webinar has 200 people. So, you know, how to contact with the NGOs, the slum dwellers, the informal segment, the traders of Delhi who've suffered huge losses in the last 2 years in the pandemic, how they can revive their businesses. I feel they need to have more workshops, more, like, now if things, we are not hit by the third wave, you know, touch wood, then they can have workshops, go at the ground level. You can't just have a webinar with 200 people and say, okay. So I feel more, and till date, as we're talking, they've only received 1,500, you know, online suggestions. So it shows, and why it should only be written, it can even be verbal, it can be audio, you can go and make videos with people, talk to them. You know, everybody doesn't have the skill of reading 500 pages and making comments, you know, people don't have even the time. So I think there are other ways of documenting, having workshop, role play, where people give their reactions on things, even involving women and gender, children.
Okay, but finally,
one issue, you know, which they need to take up. Women's safety has been, yes. And when they are talking of this nightlife in Delhi to make it a night city, so safety will be one important concern.
Okay, so finally, and what you've spoken about is the major state actor, that's the DDA. What if the state actor doesn't respond? What should be the alternate, with various groups, civil society organizations, political leadership in the town? I mean, what should be the course that one should adopt? I mean, if the voices are to be heard, because, I mean, it's a serious challenge, definitely. During the pandemic, people also do not respond that vibrantly because people have different priorities at the moment. So is there anything that you want to suggest on that aspect?
I feel even if you look at, they have total 18 planning zones, they have a number of wards. Even if they do in every planning zone, they do on-ground consultations, calling the local councillor. The case of Delhi is like DDA is not an elected body, you know. So what the counselors feel, what is the feedback from the counselors, I don't think that has been incorporated. And then you have Delhi government, which is another parallel, you know. So there are multiple actors in Delhi. And finally, the master plan, they say it's a guiding document. Implementation has to either be by these municipal corporations or the Delhi government. So that thing, who will do what and what will be the timelines, it remains a challenge.
But the master plan happens to be a statutory document, no? I mean, because, you know, the Delhi government is part of it, municipal corporation is part of it.
They are part in the board, but I don't know how much of their suggestions have been taken on board. That is what I think. It needs to be even ward level representatives, ward committees, you know, to take their suggestions on board should be done. And master plan, we know that we have been doing since 61. So how much every master plan has achieved, that also we've seen. There have been huge gaps. So it's but not...
At least in the previous master plans, when you did not achieve, 20 years down the line, you said, okay, this is what was left out. I don't think that kind of understanding...
This master plan is totally silent. It doesn't talk of what was proposed in 2021, what they could achieve. And they have added some fancy new terms. And one thing that they've added is vertical mixing. Last master plan was more about mixed use, you know, like Lajpat Nagar and around 2500 streets.
They allowed this one you said is more about vertical mixing.
Yeah, because so in these POD and these zones, they want to allow vertical mixing of use. And giving a very high FSI of 5, you know. I'm not sure, I think it's more for the
real estate builders, I mean, who may get some opportunity to...
Finally, if you look at all the players, even the developer or a real estate person is a player, you know, they are also one of the parties because they are also contributing to the city. So their interests need to be seen. And now DDA, earlier they were making their own housing, you know, you had different DDA colonies. Now they have left it to that the private sector will invest.
Yeah, they abandoned that idea completely. Yes, now.
I think Vasant Kunj maybe. After 2005 or 10, no major DDA houses or apartments, nothing of that has come up. So private players will play an important role. And because we are seeing a lot of, as they talk of regeneration, a lot of areas which were built, you know, 50, 60 years old, they are getting old, they will need upgradation. Even regeneration, private players are going to play an important role. But the challenge will be that whether the infrastructure would be available for a 5 or a 4 FSI, you know. So we are not talking on the infra part, but that will have to be seen.
Absolutely. Thank you, Jasmine, for making those very interesting observations. And, you know, many of the players have also pointed out that 1 month down the line is too less for the people to commit. At least 3 more months should be given to the people.
3 months that you should have active workshops. In Hong Kong, they did some 250 consultations. You look at, because now Delhi is the size of a small state in India.
Actually, yeah. And they have a budget for more than a state, some of the states in India, definitely. So thank you, Jasmine, for being with us and making those very interesting observations. And I wish that, the aspects that you pointed out are taken care of. And, you know, the alternative also, the whole purpose of running the series is to really energize, to really make people aware that, look, hey, this is your Delhi and reclaim this right of planning. Unfortunately, this right doesn't accrue through the DDA, in fact, which should have accrued through the DDA planning process. So this is also to actually hit out the process. I mean, the entire process is faulty, the way they plan. And as Dhunu pointed out, we shouldn't leave planning only to the ustads. I mean, that's the consultants. So the people.
A city is because of its people, you know. And the logo ki marzi hai, jo logo ke man ki baat hai, wo to janna bahut zaruri hai.
Yeah, thank you.
Isko bhi aapko lena padega.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank